This program contains a PDF of football plays and charts. Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Perfect Pass, American Genius and the Reinvention of Football by S.C. Gwynne. Read by Santino Fontana, with an afterword read by the author.
For my wife, Katie, who encouraged me to write this book, and for my daughter, Maisie, who came up with its title. We decided that since football is a game with a ball in it, we should use the ball. We should let the boys play with the ball. We should put the ball in the air. We should let people see the ball. Glenn Tiger Ellison, head football coach, Middletown, Ohio High School, 1945 to 1963. Now and then we had a hope that if we lived and were good, God would permit us to be pirates. Mark Twain. Chapter 1. The Mad Pirate's Revenge. The Red Raiders are almost out of time. With 1 minute and 23 seconds left in the game, Texas Tech's football team trails the University of Texas 33-32. They have the ball on their own 38-yard line, 62 yards from the end zone. They have one timeout left, but the clock is just one of their problems. Texas is the top-ranked team in the country, loaded with future NFL draft picks. In the previous 3 weeks, the Longhorns have beaten consecutively the 1st, 11th, and 7th ranked teams in the nation, on whom they have hung a collective 129 points. Texas's Heisman candidate quarterback, Colt McCoy, has just engineered a textbook-perfect 11-play, 80-yard touchdown drive to take the lead. On the Texas sideline, you can see that the horns are juiced. They are chest-bumping. They are jumping up and down. They are screaming. So are the 56,000 Red Raiders fans in the stands, who have watched agonizingly as their team's 22-6 lead has steadily vaporized in the second half. They are desperate to win. Tech is ranked 6th, a rare occurrence in itself, and has never beaten a number one ranked team in its 85-year history. The game has been wildly hyped. The West Texas campus has been turned into a giant free-floating pep rally. ESPN's College Game Day Carnival has trundled into town with its 15,000 hangers-on. An elaborate tent city with 2,000 residents has sprung up around the stadium, loaded with so much digital technology and generator-powered electricity that it glows at night. But as the clock ticks perilously toward zero, the feeling in Lubbock on this warm November night in 2008 goes much deeper than that. In spite of the odds, Tech fans believe, as an article of unwavering faith, that they will win. They do not doubt it. That is not just because their football team is having an exceptional year. The real reason is that they are the possessors of what is, by the traditional standards of the Big 12 Conference and the rest of the NCAA, a sort of gridiron black magic, a brand of offense so profoundly different from what their opponents play, so alien to the conventions of the rest of American football, and so astoundingly effective that for almost a decade it has consistently defied the best efforts of the best defensive minds in football to stop it. They call it the air raid. That's because the magic is in the air. Balls thrown and balls caught. In their hearts, the citizens of Red Raider Nation do not believe that it can be stopped. Most of America is seeing the offense's oddities for the first time, as Texas Tech sets up at the line of scrimmage. Conventional wisdom holds that offensive linemen should position themselves close together so that there is no more than a foot or foot and a half between them, creating the effect of an impenetrable wall. Often they are closer than that. Texas Tech's offensive linemen are, as one amazed commentator puts it, strung out from here to Amarillo. There are 4 more feet between the center, guards, and tackles, creating a line that looks, when viewed from the end zone, shockingly porous, as though any self-respecting linebacker could just walk right through those vast open spaces and kill the quarterback. Nobody lines up like this. The linemen, moreover, did not get down in the normal 3 or 4 point stance, ready to fire out like everybody else. Instead, they stand, hands resting lightly on their thighs, looking like men waiting for a bus. Nor do they even position themselves on the line of scrimmage. They are set back from it, deeper than the center. Football traditionalists would tell you that they look like a group of fat men who are about to be knocked backward onto their Buick-sized hindquarters, while the defensive tackles and linebackers ravage the backfield. Tech has been setting up this way for years. Hardly anyone, anywhere, does any such thing. Where did this madness come from? The simple answer is Texas Tech's coach, a slender, mild-mannered man of average height who never played football in college. His name is Mike Leach. He is the proximate antithesis of the beefy, square-jawed drill sergeants who have populated American football since the 19th century. He has a law degree from Pepperdine University. His intellectual interests range from history, Apaches, pirates, Wyatt Earp, the Vikings, Winston Churchill, Daniel Boone, Napoleon Bonaparte, to the tango, the philosophy of John Wooden, the music of Jimmy Buffett, and, because he is a surfer, the dynamics of offshore breaks in San Onofre, California. When recruiting players, he does card tricks and tells pirate stories. In conversation, he generally wants to talk about anything other than football. But when he does think about football, interesting things happen. During his 9-year tenure at Texas Tech, he has compiled a 73-37 record. But those numbers tell you nothing. He has accomplished that while playing in one of the nation's toughest conferences and using players that few or no other elite college football programs wanted. In 5 of those 9 years, Texas Tech, running its mysterious pass-crazy air raid system, led the nation in offense, routinely hanging ungodly numbers of points on the opposition. Leach's first quarterback, Cliff Kingsbury, set the all-time NCAA record for career completions. His second, B.J. Simmons, passed for the most yardage in a single season in NCAA history. His third and fourth, Sonny Cumbie and Cody Hodges, also led the nation in passing. Simmons, Cumbie, and Hodges, moreover, were all fifth-year seniors who only started for a single season. Leach's current quarterback, Graham Harrell, who has actually played 3 years, was the first quarterback in NCAA history to have multiple 5,000-yard-plus seasons. His completion rate is an astonishing 70%. He will soon set the all-time NCAA record for career touchdown passes with 134. Tech never huddles and plays blazingly fast, running as many as 90 plays a game compared with the NCAA and NFL average of 65. The Red Raiders throw 50 or 60 passes a game, sometimes more. They rarely punt, even on 4th and 4 from their own 35-yard line. They disdain field goals. To say that Tech's air raid offense can score quickly is to understate the point. In 2004, the Red Raiders were trailing a good TCU team 21-0, with 8 minutes to go in the second quarter. It looked like a blowout. One of the TCU defensive backs was even captured on camera saying, "They aren't gonna score." Texas Tech won the game 70-35, behind 5 touchdown passes and 441 yards of spectacular aerial offense. That same year, Tech rang up 70 points on Nebraska, the most that had been scored against the Cornhuskers in their 114-year history. In the 2006 Insight Bowl, trailing Minnesota 38-7, in the third quarter, Texas Tech rallied to win 44-41 in overtime, the greatest comeback in NCAA bowl history. This is why Raiders fans believe. When Tech lost, it was often no fault of the offense. In 2007, the Raiders went down to Texas 59-43 and to Oklahoma State 49-45. Air raid is an offensive, not a defensive system. Leading up to the Texas game in 2008, Tech is undefeated and averaging 48 points a game. 10 of its scoring drives this year took less than 1 minute and 30 seconds, which is just a little bit more time than Mike Leach has now, facing a dazzling, adrenaline-pumped array of all the talent he has no access to. With 1 minute, 23 seconds to go, Harold zips an 8-yard pass over the middle to running back Baron Batch. He follows it with a swing pass for a first down, then an 11-yard dart to wideout Detron Lewis at the 38-yard line. With 28 seconds to go, Harrell, dead calm in the pocket, hits the other wide receiver, Edward Britton, down the left sideline for 10 yards and another first down. Unbeknownst to almost everyone watching this game, two of the four passes Harrell has thrown are actually the same play, known as four verticals, a sort of backyard, everybody-go-deep play that has been adapted to the air raid attack. The Texas defensive coaches, on the other hand, know all about four verticals. They can diagram it in their sleep. They know exactly what Tech is doing, but they can't stop it. This is the true beauty of the air raid, the reason it will be written about in history next to the single wing and the wishbone. With 15 seconds to go, Leach calls four verticals again. This time the ball is deflected off the hands of Texas defensive back Blake Gideon. There are 8 seconds left. The crowd is hysterical, a stadium full of shimmering, dancing patterns of red and black. 56,000 fans scream.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.